Hi, everyone. I'm Chai Bandlamudi. I'm a graduate student at Kevin White Lab at the University of Chicago. First, I want to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present my work. I'm going to talk about the work we've been doing to identify recurrent fusions from the TCGA cohort. So the first part of my talk is going to be on the approach we take to identify these fusions. And then I'm going to talk about some of the results and end up with some of the functional validations we've done on this. So COSMIC maintains a database of known fusion genes. If you look at it, similar to some of the power law distributions we saw earlier today, so COSMIC maintains a database of known fusion genes. About 1% of them, less than 10% of them should have a frequency of greater than 1%, so which is kind of interesting. So there's an interesting, few interesting things from this is that if you look at the tissue specificity, some of these known recurrent fusion genes, for example, TMPRSS2, ERG is very prostate cancer specific, and some of the fusions like the FGFR3 tag are, you see across multiple different tissue types. So there are a few future directions, like how is this distribution gonna change with larger sample sizes and more sensitive methods to detect fusions. So so the basic, there are two pieces of evidence that that we need to identify, make a fusion call. So the reads that are mapping to two different genes, these are called discordant reads, and the reads that are mapping to the fusion junction, these we call as anchor reads. And the specificity of this anchor read is determined by this anchor length, which is the minimum of the two overhang regions, the left and right. So this is the anchor length. So as you know, one of the main challenges in the fusion discovery is the high false positive rate. And this is primarily because of misalignment of this read to this fusion junction. And this can happen in several different ways. First is if this read aligns to, this read that's mapping to this junction can align to one of the two genes of the fusion incomplete. And also it can align to another gene called gene C, or it can align to an unannotated transcriptional locus. And these things, it's very incredibly hard to computationally identify these sorts of artifacts. So we attempted to control for some of these artifacts, and we implemented this approach in a method called Mojo. This identifies fusions between at canonical exon-exon junctions. So the basic approach is similar to the most of the other methods that are out there, but the novelty comes in the way we filter for these various artifacts, and also the approach we take to align to identify these candidate fusion genes. So this is on, I have a poster out, so I'm not going to go into detail about this. Please feel free to come by. So obvious thing is like, how are we gonna evaluate this? So the way I evaluated Mojo in comparison with 9 other published methods using a compendium of 18 cell line transcriptomes, these have validated fusions. And so there's a list of 131 fusions with that are known with experimental validation, and I'm comparing these with some of the other published methods. And I want to make a point that all the parameters are consistent across all these methods. So if you look at some of these methods that show similar sensitivity, despite that, you see like there's a significant discordance between the types of fusions they call. So we're showing like very good sensitivity, but what about false positive rate? So instead of false positives, I'm gonna call these as low confidence fusions because we don't have evidence to say that these are like false positives. We don't have experimental evidence. You'll notice that some of them share, some of these calls are shared by more than one of these methods. These could be polymorphic, or these could be new fusions that haven't yet been validated. But you see a lot of fusion calls that are singleton to, that are specific to each of these methods. And I should point out that some of these methods are designed to identify fusions involving intronic regions and breaks in the middle of exons, therefore larger search space and like more number of calls. So what I'm showing to the right is a false discovery rate plot. So the anchor length is a proxy for like confidence in a fusion call. So the increasing number of anchor reads you expect to gain more specificity. But it's a proxy, it's a weak proxy, because you can have a fusion call with only one anchor read because it's like low expressed. So we've taken this this algorithm and ran this on nearly 7,200 tumor transcriptomes. One thing I want to point out is the median runtime across all these methods is around between four and five hours for an 80 million paired and read sample. And these are run on a machine with each node has 24 cores and 32 gigs of memory. So despite our efforts to control for like false positives, since we are looking at large number of samples, inevitably we're going to see some recurrent fusions that are false positives. So the way we accounted for that is as follows. So we ran Mojo in the highest sensitivity mode, requiring only two discordant reads and one anchor read of 10 base pairs. And then first, the way we do singletons is singleton calls, the one without the recurrence, is requiring two anchor reads, two proper anchor reads. We define this as an anchor read, one end of the anchor read mapping to the junction with the largest overhang mapping to the other gene than its paired read maps to. And for the recurrent fusions, we pool the reads across all samples, and we look for this sort of uniform distribution at the fusion junction. And we filter out reads that are biased to the gene A or gene B, these sorts of most likely alignment artifacts. And then we require similar one fusion call with high stringency or high confidence fusion call. So we compile these fusion calls, and then to account for some of the annotation artifacts in the human genome and transcriptome, and also some to take out some polymorphic fusions, we ran our algorithm on nearly 1,800 normal transcriptomes in the genotype and tissue expression database, and we'll filter out all calls that overlap with this. And similarly with the TCGA 674 paired normal transcriptomes. So we identified we identified 15,600 high confidence somatic fusion calls. So are we capturing all the known ones? So I compiled a list of fusions from the different marker papers, and we are capturing most of them. The only one that we missed was it's a non-canonical fusion that has a break in the middle of the exon. Interestingly, we're also capturing some of the fusions with much higher sensitivity. For example, FGFR3, TAC3, we're finding it at 20% frequency in the glioblastoma, significantly higher than what's been reported before. And some of the other fusions in this tumor type, we're also finding it at some higher frequency. It's interesting to note that 11 out of the 26 different tumor types we analyzed have at least one fusion, one FGFR3, TAC3 fusion. So looking at the distribution of these fusion calls, obviously breast and ovarian have large number of samples, therefore you see higher number of calls, and most likely because they have a lot of copy number alterations too. So if you look at known cosmic and novel fusions, approximately 9% of all the fusion calls have a gene involving a cosmic gene or known fusion gene. And the distribution of number of fusions per sample across the different tumor types. Some of the solid tumors have like higher number of fusion calls per tumor. And you see some tumor types like the thyroid, adrenal tumor types showing like very few fusions. So one thing to look at is like, are these fusions caused by local rearrangements or distal long-range rearrangements like translocations or rearrangements farther than 10 megabases? So the interesting thing you see with this thyroid cancer is that it has far fewer rearrangements, but most of them are like distal. And some of the leukemia, as expected, show like higher number of translocations. And if you look at the distribution of samples that have at least one fusion or more than one fusion, you see this sort of pattern where like tumors that are certainly very highly ranged, like ovarian, have like large number of fusions, and some of them have greater than 20. These are candidates for chromothripsis and so on. And another thing is approximately more than 75% of the thyroid tumors do not have a fusion, yet there's like quite a large fraction of them have like are a known driver, potentially driver fusion. So again, this is the same pattern with the ovarian. I'm just trying to reiterate the large number of rearrangements in the ovarian tumor. And you see fewer rearrangements but large number of translocations here. And with the thyroid, like fewer rearrangements and many known cancer genes. So these are some of the novel fusions we found. There are some interesting ones in here. For example, this fusion involving BMPR1B is seen in breast, ovarian, and prostate, and these are all hormone-driven cancers. And some fusions like ESR1, CCDC, it's found in MCF7A cell line 2. Some of them are interesting, and we're like following up on functional validation on some of these. So our approach for functional validations is we synthesize a fusion construct, package them into viral particles, and create stable cell lines expressing the fusion construct, and perform three different types of assays, proliferation, invasion, and evasion of apoptosis. So I'm going to show some preliminary data on 11 fusion constructs we built using this pipeline in MCF10A cell line, and we did proliferation assays. And we assayed two different phenotypes, the EDU and cell titer glow, once for DNA synthesis and one for ATP metabolism. So these are some of the, so we have two positive controls here, FGFR3, TAC3, and PMLRRA. You can see that some of these fusions show greater proliferation than FGFR3, TAC3. You can argue that FGFR3, TAC3 is not, it's not as endogenous environment in MCF10A. Yet it's interesting we are replicating these assays in NIH3T3 cells. You'll notice that the one oddity here is that we have two isoforms of this fusion. One doesn't have a DNA binding domain, and one has a DNA binding domain. So the one with the DNA binding domain shows significant increase in proliferation. So in summary, we're repeating these assays in NH3D cells, and we're overexpressing full-length individual genes as controls. And then follow with further functional validations, analysis, and so on. So another thing that I didn't bring up is that recurrently fused genes, not the fused gene pairs, but the genes are also interesting. And finally, integrating this analysis with copy number alterations, mutations, and fusion events is of significant interest, just looking at the bigger scale of like genomic instability and what drives these alterations. So finally, I want to thank Pei-Chun Lin, a postdoc in our lab that has, spent an incredible amount of time and effort trying to set up these experimental validations and following up on them and so on. And I want to thank my advisor, Kevin, and some of our like helpful lab mates, and the Bionimbus team for providing the TCGA data, and the Beagle supercomputer for providing computing resources and so on. Thank you very much.
I'm interested in what the influence of depth of RNA sequencing would be on your discovery. So in the amount that we've been usually doing in TCGA, the number of reads, has that maxed out your discovery rate, or can you model whether you'd do a lot better with much deeper RNA sequencing?
Absolutely. The more you deeper, you tend to pick up more clonal events. So a large fraction of our fusions have only one or two supporting reads, and we're able to pick them up because we have some samples that are deeply sequenced, or in those samples, that is actually a clonal event compared to the subclonal event.
But
so
then using that, can you model how, if we were going to do a new project,
sure,
how deep would we want to sequence RNA?
If you have an estimate of what's the clonality, or what sort of clonal events or what's the purity of certain tumor type that you expect, you can model it. We have enough data to look at that.
Have you tried to validate by RT-PCR followed by Sanger sequencing some of the fusions you have?
That's a very good point. So we don't have material for some of or most of these. So the way we're looking at it is looking in whole genome sequencing.
So I ask this question because I'm a little bit concerned for some calls, in particular the FGFR3-TAC3 fusion in GBM.
Right.
We have been studying the fusion for quite a long time, and we definitely know that the frequency is not 20%. Okay. In particular, the problem there might be, I would suggest, that in some batch of RNA-seq tumors, there are real positives with a very high expression of the fusion gene that contaminate a lower level, also all the other samples in that batch. So I would suggest that you give a look to that possibility.
To the validations, yeah. Mm. That is pretty, contamination is pretty hard to...
I wish you are right in that case, because that would make therapeutic trials much easier if we had the frequency, but unfortunately that's not the case.
Okay. I think we need to move on. We'll take the remaining questions after the talk or at the poster session. Our next speaker is Audrey Fu from University of Chicago, presenting on widespread genetic epistasis among cancer genes.